So the time having arrived, I hereby call this meeting of the Brockton School Committee to order. I invite you to please rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. So at this point, I'll entertain a motion to go into recess for approximately 15 minutes so that the Finance Subcommittee can conclude their meeting.
Motion to go into recess for 15 minutes for the purpose of finishing the Finance Subcommittee meeting in that time.
Okay, motion's been made, seconded by Mr. Gormley. All in favor? Approved. So at this point, the regularly scheduled school committee meeting is in recess. I need a motion for us to come back from recess for the regular school committee meeting. Okay, seconded by Ms. Plant. All in favor? Okay. So now the Brockton School Committee meeting is back in session. I'll apologize to the folks that came in expecting us to start at 7 o'clock. But we will go right into our regular agenda now. The first order of business is hearing of visitors. And we don't have anyone that has signed in for this week's meeting to be heard as a visitor. So I'll move right on to the consent agenda. The consent agenda is a block of regular school committee business that's considered as one block in its entirety in order to expedite the meeting. However, any member of the committee may request that any individual item from the consent agenda be removed for separate discussion and consideration. So at this time, I'll just poll the committee to see if there are any members here that would like to remove an item from the consent agenda. Okay, hearing and seeing none, I'll entertain a motion on the consent agenda in its entirety. Okay, motion's been made, seconded by Mr. Minicello. All in favor? Approved unanimously. So at this point, I'll turn the meeting over to Superintendent Smith for the superintendent's report on teaching and learning.
Thank you, Mayor Carpenter. I'm so pleased to start the meeting this evening to recognize somebody who is a graduate of Brockton High School, I believe the class of 1991. And really, when he heard the call to come forward and give of himself in service to his school and to his school district, Hugh McGlone was one of those people that never hesitated. Hugh McGlone was president of our BHS Alumni Association in its very earliest years. It's certainly, if I look back, and I believed he served for 8 years plus is what it says here. He is stepping down, and I had the opportunity to have lunch with him a couple of months back and really catch up. He's in a master's program for, I believe, hospital administration. He has a very young family. His wife, I see everybody here this evening. And I didn't even think about trying to talk him out of it because I know what he had done for those 8 years. Since coming on as superintendent, and I do have to say, Hugh, I know you way back when you were at Brockton High School and the things you were able to do on the basketball court, right?
I wish.
Oh, I thought it was. But he has really been instrumental in working with our Alumni Association, with a number of other people who are certainly here this evening. I see Ann Beauregard, Mary Waldron. I'm sorry if I'm missing anybody else out there that is part of it. Oh, I see Kyle Landerholm, correct?
And
Nick Payon, thank you for being here this evening. So I'd like to invite Hugh McGlone to come down here. We want to give him a certificate and offer him our thanks for certainly... So we're first going to give you this plaque and certificate. Okay. You, I'm going to let the mayor hand that to you, and I'll give you this to hold for the pictures. I'm going to have you come in. Would you like to have your family come and join us for this picture? No?
If they'd like to, come on down.
Yeah. Come on. They'll thank you years from now.
Yes, yes.
I know how much time he's been away from home all this time. So please come join us. Hi there.
Hello, this is Catherine, another Hugh, and my
Catherine,
wife,
Hugh, I'm going to let you get right in. Beth, how are you? Thank you so much.
Superintendent Smith.
Thank you, and Hugh, can you stay? Can we have the alumni group come down? Could we have the alumni group come down? Ann, Nick, Carl, Mary? Mary, you've been part of the Alumni Association. Come on, Mary, John would be proud. Come on.
I know.
Little one push down here and we'll get people in. Nick, wherever you want.
Okay. All right.
If there's anybody else I've missed that is part of the Alumni Association.
There we go.
Only you, Mary. And we'll put that up on the web.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you. I really
appreciate
it. Do you
have remarks? Would you like to make
remarks?
Yeah, you know, please join us at the microphone.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. Thank you.
He's going to have a few remarks.
Yeah.
That's
right.
Thank you. No, I didn't see.
So, I'll keep it brief, but thank you so much for the recognition. It's been an honor to serve as the president of the Alumni Association for the past 8 years. The first thing that came to mind when I was standing back there is give back to where it all started. That's our motto, and I know that everybody in this room fully understands that, but there's just been so many students who have gone through these halls, who have gone on to do great things. And we've scratched the surface the past, or a little bit more than scratched the surface. I want to thank my team. You know, without everybody who's here, you know, none of this would happen. There's a lot of work that was done by the folks who are up on stage and others, and I want to thank them. But certainly, you know, you look at Brockton High School, biggest high school this side of the Mississippi, and we have a huge opportunity still in front of us in terms of reaching out to alums and helping the students of today. The best aspect of the past 8 years is making those phone calls to the parents and the students, recognizing their accomplishments and giving them their scholarships. The students and parents are just elated, and it's just an unbelievable feeling to be able to contribute to the furthering of their education. So I really appreciate everything that you all have done for the organization, and like I said, give back to where it all started. And I just want to hats off to all of my colleagues and continued success. There's still a lot of work to do, and I know that the people assembled here today will certainly follow through. So thank you all. I really appreciate it. So thanks.
To bring to everybody's attention. I'm sure many of you have heard that today we have a new Secretary of Education at the federal level, Betsy DeVos. I'm sure many of you followed what that confirmation hearing was all about. I can't tell you that I don't have concern. We will be carefully watching as Secretary of Education some of the things that have been out there. One of the things that concerned me was Sunday I was watching TV and there was a commercial. And, you know, commercials are what they are. And it was make sure you get to your state senator to talk about, you know, vouchers and charters and parochial school. And I had to look at my legal, put my legal hat on and say, there is a separation of church and state here. So I'm concerned about those tax dollars, making sure that they continue to support our public school students, making sure, again, that we are the best public school system that we can be. And when you think about this, when you think about the state and the federal government, one of the things the Constitution left for all of us, because it's not mentioned in the Constitution, and I think it's under Article 10, is that those that are not mentioned in the Constitution are reserved for the states. So our state oversees our educational system. I did hear from the commissioner today, and that was a phone call to superintendents around the state. Like this new administration, Betsy DeVos deserves a chance. But I do want to tell you that we'll be looking at things very carefully and making sure that, again, I never would have thought this job was about advocacy, the amount that it has become. But we will safeguard, you know, especially our precious dollars, our budget, our Title I funds that are federal, and making sure that these things remain intact for our students. So that was a vote. I think the final vote did happen today, and we were alerted to that. I also want to mention, and this is another area that concerns us. The mayor and I have had a number of conversations about this, and many of you are seeing things happen on the national level with travel bans and questions about immigration. You know, we are certainly a city of immigrants, and the mayor and I are committed to continue doing the work that we're doing and to make sure that our children are safe and secure in the walls of the so-called school doors. We'll continue to educate them. We'll continue, again, to fight for every dollar to make sure our children are supported in the way that we need them to be supported so they can go on and be productive members of our society. We also are working very closely with our bilingual department, and we're having a workshop actually for parents on the 21st of March. We're going to be having an immigration lawyer who actually serves on the Chamber of Commerce with myself and obviously a number of other members. She'll be working with our director, Kelly Jones. We invite parents to come in. We invite to share with them their rights and the supports that they have. So we will continue to do that within legal bounds, obviously. But I do want to say that to all our parents out there, that your children are important. We want them to feel safe and secure when they walk into our classrooms every day. And Mayor, you and I have certainly had conversation about this.
Absolutely.
Okay.
I don't want to slow you down.
Okay, I know. as far as speaking of all of these things, we do have a budget update. We were given the governor's budget, House Budget 1. I believe it was on the 26th of January. And I'd like to invite our chief budget officer, Aldo Petronio, just to give you, again, a quick snapshot. This is obviously something that we'll be talking about in our upcoming budget. Before he speaks, I want to talk to you about a couple of things. There is a conference coming up. It's called A Conference on Poverty. It is on March 10th. They're inviting superintendents from all over the state. They're inviting school committee members. It's going to be at Clark University. I have been asked to actually present on the impact of direct certification on our district, because once again, our district is probably one of 10 or 11 around the state that it clearly is impacting us, this direct certification requirement, more than other districts. This is something that Deputy Commissioner Jeff Wolfson spoke about last Friday at a meeting I was at for urban superintendents. They are also trying to put together, as they look at this budget and see the impact on places like Brockton. I'm hopeful they're going to be able to solve this dilemma. That being said, we also have a legislative breakfast set for March 24th, 2017, to start discussion with our legislative group that will be at Central Administration to have many of these discussions. And the other thing that I think, again, when we talk about advocacy, is the Foundation Budget Review Commission. And remember, 2 years ago, we were part of that with people all over the state. The report out was, I believe, the fall of 15, and the governor has not enacted any of those recommendations, and it is time to start to look at that Foundation Budget Review Commission.
And there is a bill, I believe it's HB 1905.
That sound right, Aldo? That Sonia Chang Diaz from Boston has proposed to implement the commission's recommendations. So please advocate with our state delegation and any other state representatives that you want like to contact to get that passed, because that would be the magic bullet, I guess you would say, to solve a lot of these issues.
Thank you, and that was brought up on Friday also to support that. So, Mr. Petronio.
Legislative breakfast is on the 17th?
It's on the 24th. You're talking March 24th, 2017. What the 9:30?
9:30, okay.
I think we're just confirming all of the legislative group that they're able to attend.
Okay.
My plan is for us to have all our advocacy points, you know, to them at that time, and to really come up with some of the things that we're doing. You know, we're already looking at, last night I attended a CPAC meeting, Special Education Parent Advisory Council meeting, and the talk was there about the Brockton Kids Count campaign. So I'm working with Michelle Bolton, that is part of our strategic plan, one of our goals in our strategic plan. We will be renewing that promise to our students and making sure we're putting the heat on so that the types of things that need to be looked at, clearly when you look at our low income, that's been a real area of concern for us. 4,500 students don't just fall away.
Right.
And this year, when you go back last year, we were held harmless to the tune of $6.5 million. Chief Budget Officer Petronio warned me to be very careful about that. And sure enough, when we start to get into the nitty-gritty about this budget, you're going to see that that hold harmless went away for this year. That's $6.5 million. Those children are still sitting in front of us.
And on that note, Madam Superintendent, should we, in addition to obviously the paperwork that's being done to take into account those students that reach that are at that certain line, financial poverty level line, should we continue using the old method so that we can compare, you know, what is now in place and what our number is with, if we were using direct certification with the lunch forms, so that we have a look at doing it your way, state, we come up with X number. Doing it our way, the old way, we come up with, you know, 4,500 more kids, and that is again in you know, this upcoming year, so that we basically use that as evidence to either make our argument you know, in writing or make our argument legally.
And Mr. Minicello, you were with me certainly as a group when we went in and saw Undersecretary Tom Moreau in Boston. And one of the things he talked about at that time was the so-called systemic bias. So you're correct, when you talk about 80% of our students were on free and reduced lunch, that was the calculation we used with the state. That was that 6.5 million a year ago. When you look at the complicated system now, it was divided into what they call deciles. Decile 10 gives you the most amount of money, and districts fall, 300 and however many districts in the state, all fall in one of those deciles. We fall in that largest decile. If we were to be able to take our 4,500 students that just kind of fell by the wayside,
right,
and we actually have done a good job, but not a great job. When you look at last year, we went from 81% to, let's say, 55%. So we've risen a few percentages, and some of that is based on they're not matching the names correctly. You know, there's a letter missing, a misspelling in a last name because the systems aren't talking to each other. So the state is cleaning that up, but certainly when you look at decile 10, it would be millions of dollars
right,
more if we were to add those 4,500 students there.
So the disparity still exists. So if we basically, you know, again, qualify the students based on what the current law is, but we also quantify the number of students based on how we used to do it with the free lunch forms or reduced lunch forms. And again, we come up with our number yet another year and show them this is our evidence of what we are being shortchanged, basically. And it's a matter of we either have to force the issue, you know, one way or another, because we cannot, we can't, like you said, we all know we have these students, but we're not being funded for them, and that is so unfair and outrageous.
I want to make it clear, Mr. Minicello, because one of the things that was said at a public forum, when you talk about our students' low income, we are getting our per pupil, you know, cost for them as of that October 1st date. But you get additional money on top of that for different categories, special education, a bilingual student, a student in poverty. And that's where, so we do get the money for those students. It's not that we're not getting any money for the students, but we're not getting that added poverty level
that
we need to
get. But we're grossly shortchanged.
Oh, absolutely.
So, Mr. Petronio, I know it's a lot of work because, you know, you're basically, I'm asking you to calculate the number of these students using two systems, the old system and the new system. But my point on using the old system is we'll get a true number of, again, what our damages are, what our loss is, our financial loss. And then we use that, you know, as our...
We are currently doing something very similar to that.
Okay.
We've been targeting the 4,500 students that have fallen off the lists.
Yeah.
And we have a person now whose job is to basically go and survey them and have them fill out almost like a financial questionnaire.
Right.
That has pretty much the same information that the lunch application had, but again, specifically for us.
Right.
The problem we run into is that they want you to match that against a state, you know, entitlement program.
Right.
And if they're not on it, so, but we have been working on collecting.
As we all know, there's a lot of reasons why some people don't sign up for benefits.
Yes.
And, you know, if they don't meet the financial criteria, you know, for whatever reason, then those students, you know, basically are deserving of that additional supplemental income.
Yes.
And I hear what you're saying, but that doesn't get in the net, the new students coming in, you know, at the kindergarten level, nor will it get in some of the students that come into the district that are new to the district but might be coming in the sixth grade or the fifth grade or the 11th grade. You know, so... Again, I know it's a lot of work, but it will establish our loss. It will establish
right.
our damages.
We are making advances towards that. I can show you
okay.
at our next finance meeting, I guess, exactly what we're doing to collect that data from incoming students.
I just don't want to shortchange the district. I don't
right.
want to shortchange our number, our financial loss,
mm-hmm.
because I want every penny for these kids that they deserve and that the district deserves in order to provide for them.
I mean, agree.
You know, so... We got to do it.
I passed out just a quick summary of the governor's budget. It's just the two pages I gave you with the graph on the front page. I know we don't have a lot of time tonight, but this is you can begin reviewing so that when we have our first finance committee meeting, you'll have some information. But from the middle to the right-hand side of the page, what you'll see is comparison to FY17. First line is the enrollment. Look across to the right, FY17, FY18. You can see we went up by 214 students. That's worth about $2.5 million right there, having that many more students on our rolls. Our foundation budget, you'll see, went from $202 million to $210 million. So the state is basically saying, we're requiring you to spend $210 million this year in educating the Brockton students. Now, last year was $202 million, but what's missing from this picture is the fact that almost $7 million difference, that was made up to us last year in a hold harmless. This year, between our growth in students and our change in our population slightly, you'll see that hold harmless was made up by that increase, so we're pretty much level funded. And that was my concern last year. I thought it would take us 2 years to get up to this point, but apparently, with the number of students that we picked up and the changes, we've made it there. Problem is we're not seeing any real increase. Next line is required district contribution. So that's the city's costs. So you can see they increased what the city has to give us by $1.8 million. So they basically said that the state will give us, well, the next line down, the state gave us $171 million last year in aid. They're pretty much giving us $171 million this year in aid, pretty much level funded. The difference of $357,000, that's simply made up by, again, a token $20 per student. That was given to all the districts in the state that had no increase in their Chapter 78. That's the only difference. So they want the city to give us $1.8 million more, and they want themselves to give us $357,000 more. So a total increase of $2 million. But what you don't see on this front page is on the back side of all of this is something called the cherry sheet. That's all the aid that comes from the state to the city. So in there they have their aid for running the overall city budgets, but also in there are our costs and reimbursements on the charter school. The charter school wipes out this $2 million plus even more of it. It wipes out about $4 million in cost to us because the current year that we are in, we again are fully funded for the students that are at the charter school. Next year, that funding drops off by 75%. So we lose $2 million next year to that. And we're projected to have an increase because our charter school now is going to pick up 105 students a year, probably 90 of those from Brockton, and the other charter schools every year have picked up a few, you know, the Foxborough Charter, the South Shore, the one in Norwell, South Shore. They pick up students. So they projected students going to all of those schools, so we lose millions of there. So the mayor's side, the city side of this, is losing about $4 million overall that they fund us with. So not only are we level funded, we're also losing money this year. So what I wanted you to see basically was that Chapter 70 is pretty much level funded other than $20 a student, even though we've increased by 214 students this year, and that what they call the target age share, the state gave us 78.13% of our funds last year. This year, they're saying they're giving us 78.25%. So they're still basically funding us the exact same percentage as they were before, but it's keeping us level funded. When we get...
0.21% change is one of the lowest, if not the lowest, out of 300 and how many school districts?
351 school districts. We're about number 9 for the lowest.
We're the bottom 8.
In the whole state. You have, you know, I'm not going to pick a district, but a wealthy district that's not necessarily a neighboring town, but a South Shore town, you know, 6% increase. So it's just kind of mind-boggling as to what's really happened to, you know, our district. I mean, we can clearly see where it is.
Yes.
But it was everything we've been concerned about.
Correct. In other scenarios, in a situation like this, you would see where there's a cap of a maximum growth that a community would get. So therefore, they could take anything above that cap and fund those on the lower end of the scale. But they don't do that here. So there's Brockton and Revere that are getting, you know, 0.2 or 0.9% increases. And then there's districts you'll see, I'll pass it out at the next meeting, getting 7%, 12%, 13% increases in their district. So again, they may have picked up a few more students, but in a small district, that's a large amount of money. But again, there's certain areas like Brockton that are consistently underfunded. The next page. This is where everything is really figured out. The next page, what I did is compared FY18 to FY17. This page shows all of our students and how they break out into all the categories and how the state assumes a certain dollar amount for those categories. So across the top, you'll see from preschool to full day to elementary, junior high, high school. Breaks it out by all the grade levels, then all the areas within the school system that we run, from administration, classroom, teachers, specialists. It breaks out their formulas as to how much money you get in each one of those areas. So in the very bottom right, both in the blue sections, that's our average per pupil cost that we receive. They do a blended rate. They come up with that. Last year, we were $11,482 per child. This year, we're getting $11,741 per child. Sounds great, but that's where our hold harmless money went. It's gone because that ate it up. In the very middle, you can see I calculated, we picked up on the economically disadvantaged, the uncounted children. Out of 4,500 kids, we picked up about 368. Now that's been a lot of work. That's been matching the names. That's been going through the state databases with our databases. We have two or three people who have been assigned to work on this. What we're having problems with here is a term I want to say the mayor coined, the Trump effect. The people who we were convincing before to fill out these financial forms and to, you know, look at getting on a state assistance plan are now afraid to. So the efforts we started up to get people signed up for state benefits is now starting to slow down on us because they're afraid to register. They're afraid to be known of who they are and where they are. So that number, that 368, I was hoping to increase to 1,000 this year and to 2,000 next year. Now the concern is we don't know if we're going to get families to sign on. I mean, I don't think there's any real fear for these people, but they do. So that's something that we're going to continually work on. We're going to look if we can come up with a system with a bias that is, you know, towards these individuals. If we can identify the systematic bias, we can approach the state and say, listen, these individuals by us are claimed or is noted as being homeless. If you arrive here and you're living with a relative, you're living with a cousin, technically, state-wise, you're considered homeless. So we can argue with the state, you should consider that a category. Right now, there's only four categories. SNAP, TANF, Medicaid, or Mass Health, and two, three. I think that was was that four? SNAP, TANF, Mass Health, and Medicaid is a fourth. Those are the four categories they have. And Mass Health, which is the largest of them all, is the one database that's giving everybody the most problems in matching people up. So as they fix that, we'll pick up more students. But as the superintendent said, 4,500 students is worth $19 million to us. So. Yes.
Low income.
So that's kind of a snapshot. We'll spend a lot more time in our meetings going through more of this data, but this just came out on the 25th.
I'm going to make a couple comments, but I'll first defer to Mr. Minichiello.
I'm repeating myself, but that's why this system is fundamentally unfair, you know, and that's why we need to basically put forward the old system, because it basically shows, you know, the financial criteria that qualifies these students who are, for whatever reason, not going to sign up for these type of official benefits due to whatever reason. But, you know, the school system openly, willingly, you know, takes in everybody that basically comes down, fills out the forms. You know, we don't, you know, we aren't in the business of turning people away. We wouldn't, we don't, and we can't, nor do we want to. But, I mean, you know, the state needs to recognize that, and the state needs to fund us for these students that, you know, are on our doorstep. And, you know, the old system, you know, fairly assesses their financial criteria. The new system obviously doesn't. I mean, we're not private detectives. We're not a branch of the government responsible for, you know, enforcement of, you know, different types of immigration laws. That's not our business, mm-hmm. nor should it be. But, I mean, you know, that's why we really need to, you know, establish what our loss is. And here we are another year, a couple of years showing here's the loss. It's indisputable because here's the financial data that shows what their household income is. And we've got to make our move. I mean, we have to. It's the dollars. We're not talking about, the dollars are significant. Okay. I mean, the district is, you know, like you just said now, getting, you know, a minuscule increase, really a disgusting increase when you think about it. But yet Beacon Hill's going to be proud of itself and say, but you're getting more money than you did last year. Mm-hmm. You know, geez, thanks. You know, really appreciate the 2 cents you just gave us. You know, so we really need to establish, here's another year that we have, you know, factual proof, if we can get this data, you know, pursuant to the old system, and we've got to make our move. We need to bring this up at the legislative breakfast, you know, because we can't, you know, our district, I don't know how we're doing what we do. You know, we're running on fumes, basically. You know, it's a miracle. But, you know, I'm very concerned going forward, you know, with the same type of subtraction, you know, basically, you know, getting, you know, that shell game, giving us more, but yet because of, you know, the cherry sheet, taking away. I mean, we can only balance and handle so much. So, you know, I know, Mr. Mayor, you're on the same wavelength.
Yes, sir. We don't want to drag this out too long. We've got some time. But I just want to highlight to the school committee a couple of things that Aldo pointed out. If you go back to the front page, in the blue block, which shows the Chapter 78, last year to this year, it's about a $300,000 increase. All the way over to the right, 0.2%. So as the superintendent mentioned, that puts us in the bottom eight out of over 300 school districts in terms of percentage increase in aid, the bottom eight in the state. Then if you look just above at the top line and look at our enrollment and the change for this year, on October 1st, we were up 214 students. If nothing else changed and everything just remained the same, simple math at 11 grand a student and change, those 214 students should have generated a $2.5 million increase all by themselves without even looking at all these other issues. So you can, it's not level funded. We're being cut substantially if you really look behind the numbers and see what they're doing. That 214 students was one of the, put us in the top half a dozen in the state in terms of enrollment growth. So we've got one of the fastest growing enrollments, largest growth enrollments, and one of the lowest percentage increases in aid. It's discriminatory. There's no other word to call it. That alone is a $2.5 million problem. Then, I'll just point out a couple other things. On page two, where Aldo has highlighted the economically disadvantaged column, and you see that last year, the first year under that new process that replaced free and reduced lunch with direct certification, and that number last year at 40 million was about a $6 million decrease from the prior year in the foundation budget. But they gave us a $6 million plug last year. They said, we'll hold you harmless for the difference. Our intent was not to lower your foundation. So we'll give you a $6 million plug, $6 million and change. Now this year, go up above, you see it's 42.5, or almost exactly $2 million more. But now that's the number they're using for the foundation. So the 46.5 from last year with the plug is now only 42. There's no hold harmless plug being put in this year. So we're taking a $4 million hit this year just on the difference in the foundation budget for economically disadvantaged kids. Yep. That's a $4 million hit right there. In terms of the charter school reimbursement, and you don't see that on this sheet because that comes on the city side because they take that money right off the top and everyone gets it across the street to you guys. This year, our charter school reimbursement went down $1 million, while our charter school assessment went up $3 million. It's a net hit of $4 million on charter school reimbursement. Several inequities in there. One is that that when it's time to calculate our reimbursement, we're locked in at the last October 1st enrollment, even though we know it's gone up since then. But when they're projecting the charter school enrollments, instead of using the same October 1st date so we could get charged back on the same date that we're getting credit for, they are building in projected increases for all the charter school enrollments. So they're projecting what they think will be in those charter schools for enrollment in the upcoming year. They're guesstimating and then charging us for it. It's totally unfair. I mean, either you know, calculate both on October 1st or settle up at the end of the year when we see what the actual enrollments are. But I mean, pardon my language on TV, we're getting screwed. Royally. So one thing I do think we do need to pursue, because I think it's just a fairness argument, is that one of the reasons that reimbursement came, I guess the primary reason that reimbursement came down $1 million, is because now we go into year two of charter school reimbursement with the 230 some odd students that went to New Heights last year. The way the reimbursement works, 100% reimbursement in year one drops to 25% in year two.
Which isn't being fully funded.
Correct.
Right, which is not being fully funded. But picture this cliff, 100% year one, 25% year two. Now, if everyone remembers last year, when we had to do our budget last year, We had no idea if New Heights was ever going to open or not. They didn't even have a location at the time we were doing our budget last year. And when we had to make decisions on staffing, when we had to make decisions on facilities, when we had to finalize our budget, they still did not even have a location. How in the world could we have possibly made any budget decisions anticipating losses of middle school students for a hypothetical school that had not even been certified to open yet? And when in reality, when it came time to open on the first day of school, they couldn't. They had to get a waiver. And then they bused the kids to Norwood for 3 months. So that first year of 100% hold harmless, we never got a chance. We never got our one hold harmless year because we couldn't make those decisions last year because of the uncertainty around New Heights. So I think one of the things we need to fight for us to get another 100% year on that charter school reimbursement so that we have this 1 year to look at all these things we're going to have to look at, realigning facilities, assessing where our teaching staff needs to go, fixing class sizes, so that we can properly adjust for the loss of about 300 students from the middle schools. So I can go on for a while. I'll tell you that I'm spending a lot of time with the superintendent, Aldo and Jay Condon. And the last thing I'll mention, and Aldo mentioned it, with this direct certification, the tone and nature of the country has changed dramatically in the last month and a half, or a couple months. And being a gateway city with substantial immigrant populations, there are a lot of folks who live in our city, who have kids in our schools, who are scared to death of the future right now because they don't know what it is. And the last thing in the world they're going to do right now is give the government information about their family and who lives there and what their data is. They're not going to sign up for SNAP. They're not going to sign up for MassHealth. They're not signing up for anything because in this large group of folks we have here in these various immigrant communities, everybody's got someone that matters to them that's at risk. And they're not about to start turning information over. So this direct certification formula now, I believe even more so than last year, is absolutely discriminatory against gateway cities. The average family in Cohasset or Sharon is not worried about Trump sending their family back to whatever their country of origin was. And they are perfectly willing to fill out any forms the government wants. But that's not the case here, and it's not the case in several other cities like Brockton, like Revere,
Chelsea,
some of the others. So and I'm not an attorney, but one of the things is we consult with our attorneys about, when they say, where is the systemic bias that we need to show this inequity in funding? I think that's where it might be. The systemic bias is that they've gone to a method of calculating aid based upon a formula that they know that our students are underrepresented. And the children in those communities, and all of our children are paying the price, are not being given the same education as in more affluent communities when they're not concerned about this. So this is a horrible budget for us in terms of reimbursement from the state paying its fair share. And keep in mind, the way our, and I'm going to use round numbers, so Aldo, don't get me right to the penny, but generally speaking, our public education here in the city is funded about 80% by state aid and about 20% with local aid. That means the money that comes over out of the city budget. So for every dollar that they beat us out of the foundation budget, we've lost 80 cents of cash reimbursement because we rely on 80% of our budget to be paid for by the state. So there are a lot of inequities here around the method of calculating the economically disadvantaged, the method of reimbursing and assessing us for charter schools, the fact that we've got, you know, one of the biggest increases in enrollment in the state, but we're not getting any money for them. let alone the old built-in equity of the rolling enrollment of all the students that come in during the course of the year that we're not going to see any money for 2 years, let alone one. So I think it's, and I don't mean to sermonize here, but we are really worried about this. The impacts are dramatic. I don't know how many more budgets we can do. This calls for an additional $1.8 million from the city, but only $300,000 more from the state. I have no idea where we get the $1.8 million.
And of course, just so you know, the $20 per student was given to every town throughout the city. And don't forget, there are districts that once you reach foundation budget, go above all 10%, 20%, all the way up to 300% above foundation budget. You need an additional million for technology, here you go. So why that was looked at in that way, that every district will get an additional $20 rather than focusing on the district that truly need that,
so,
is concerning to us, certainly.
So at the end of the day, public school education is supposed to be equitable for every child in every community in the state. Every child should have the same equal opportunity to a high-quality education that ensures their future. But that is not happening now with the way the state is funding the reimbursement for local aid to education. The quality of your education should not depend upon your zip code, but that's exactly what the state is doing with these changes that they've made in the local funding to education. So we'll spend a lot of time talking about this over the next few months as we work with our legislative delegation to try to enact changes, work with legal counsel to see if we have options beyond just legislatively. It's a very discriminatory and unfair adjustments to the formula that are costing us millions of dollars and are going to force us into decisions that will hurt the education of our children. So I guess that's all I got to say. Aldo, is that basically close enough on
that's
the numbers?
That's very, very close. Very good.
Tom's raising.
I'm sorry, Tom.
You're not going to tell me that this new formula wasn't done by design. It was done by design in order to basically take from the urban centers so that they could give to the towns that have been clamoring for more funding and complaining that the urban centers, you know, have been getting, you know, a disproportionate amount of the education.
There's no doubt that that's what the effect of it is. So, shifting resources from gateway cities to more affluent suburbs.
So basically, it's time that we have to... I do not feel that their goodwill and their good faith is going to come through in order to save the day. They didn't do anything last year. We sent a letter to Mitchell Chester. He was here sitting at that table. We expressed to him what our concerns were. Well, they were very real concerns. And basically, they give us some sort of a learning grant or something, and they pat themselves on the back and they think they did the city a big favor. So to me, we're talking about millions of dollars. It's time that we need to force their hand and make our argument. And if we lose, we lose. But I really feel that the inequity can be proven, based on our loss. I mean, the loss is real. But yet the financial criteria is also real. So you can show through evidence that the financial need of these families exists, but yet they're dropping off. And there's a reason why they're dropping off, because you're basically putting in an onerous standard that, like the mayor said, is discriminatory, and it brings about the systemic bias argument. But yet, we're not in a position where we can start rapping on people's doors and saying, show me proof that you're a citizen. I mean, it's insane what they're basically trying to do to say, prove systemic bias. The fact that they've dropped off, the numbers have dropped off, speak for itself, basically.
I thank you, Mr. Mayor and Mr. Minicello, and I know the rest of the members of the committee. I will tell you a couple of things as we get into this so-called, I don't know if I dare say spring, but spring season of starting our budget. I did tell you Friday I was at the Urban Superintendents meeting. The commissioner was actually down the back of the room when Jeff Wolfson was presenting on the direct certification. I did stand up in front of 18 to 20 urban superintendents, and one of the things I said was, I reiterated our meeting with Tom Moreau, the undersecretary, the systemic bias discussion that we all had, and that we were prepared to go forward legally. And I agree, we've been talking about this for a couple of years. We've talked about goodwill and trying to advocate. So this spring, I commit to you to, as the mayor said, we will work very closely. I'm already sitting down with Aldo, putting aside days. We're kind of attached at the hip here and really looking at ways to present our data, because we do have some decisions to make. We have a budget that, you know, we have to balance in order to move forward. We are going to take a look at our legislator and have kind of a white paper on all those areas of advocacy and really reiterate to them in our position on all of these advocacy positions. And whether we go before, last year I had the opportunity with the House Ways and Means on education. We need to really be prepared, you know, working with some of the other communities and spending time on what our position is on this. We also need to, as we talked about the Foundation Budget Review Commission, a bill is certainly in. Thank you to Sonia Chang Diaz in Boston. But we need to absolutely have our plan very tight as to how we let the community help us advocate, because people will start to listen. And I am telling you that Jeff Wolfson and the commissioner's office, that does have to go before the legislator to explain their budget going forward and what they're recommending. So we will put together a timeline of all of the different opportunities for advocacy, for our budget meetings, and get those in your hands as quickly as possible. This isn't the way, and I don't know if you see the paper. Again, you've got area towns. I think the other night it was Bridgewater-Raynham School District, up by 8-point-something%. And they're settling their budgets now, and they're moving forward, and they're hiring teachers, and they're building in technology, because that is in front of you, you know, 2 years from now, your high-stakes testing, where all students, you know, have to take their, you know, high-stakes testing online. So there are many things happening here, and it is very different in the city of Brockton as we try to, you know, continue. And I agree with you. I'm not sure how we continue to do this. But thank you to our staff, who continues to work very hard, sometimes under very difficult circumstances. So are you ready to move on?
Yes,
sir. I think there are a couple of things that that I have had on here tonight I just will mention for my executive team members that are here. I did have an opportunity to go before the Diversity Commission on Thursday evening. I thank a number of you that were there with me. We answered questions. We'll continue to work with our city, our not only the district diversity, the City Diversity Commission, but also our own task force. I was going to have Dr. Moran come up and join me tonight, and we'd share with you. Our next meeting is February 22nd. There were some suggestions made. We're going to be reviewing some of those suggestions and moving forward. Dr. Moran, do you want to join me, or do we want to? I think you have to turn that mic around. I think it's, I think Mr. Petronio doesn't want us to project. So again, we answer questions about some of the changes we've made in the HR office, some of the outreach, our website, our application process. We provided certainly facts and figures. One of the things I did say was, we are looking for support from the community as we encourage teachers to come on board, but certainly we are making a difference in many of the areas. So I'm not sure if any of you have questions, or I know we're a little behind tonight. I will invite Dr. Moran to come back at another time, as I said, to do a full presentation after. Our plan is in a draft form still. We did put it up for the city the other night, but we do have a meeting on the 21st to formalize that plan. Mr. Minichiello?
Well, I'm sorry, John.
I attended the meeting with Ms. Plant, and I thought the superintendent was very open and honest, and in discussing, you know, where the state of the school system is with regard to the issues that were raised. You know, as a committee, I think we're all open to examine, you know, the district and make decisions and policy that, you know, that makes sense. So I think people need to know that sometimes circumstances that exist make change take time, and no one in this community isn't open to being inclusive. But change takes time. There's no magic wand that can be waved. I have faith that the Human Resource Department is doing what it can with respect to making sure policies and fairness are taking place, and continue to be open to have a dialogue with the members of the Diversity Commission, and we'll move forward and do what needs to be done, but we can only do what is realistic in terms of qualified people that are before us and eligible for certain positions. But I think that everyone in that meeting was open and honest, and we look forward to continuing the dialogue.
One of the things that came up was the recruitment fair in our own city. You know, certainly there are recruitment fairs in colleges and in the area, but to have our own recruitment fair across all areas, custodians, administrative assistants, all the different areas that support our schools, teachers, paraprofessionals. So Dr. Moran, what is the date on that?
I believe it was the 27th that we have it planned for. It's in the beginning stages, but we'll be sending out flyers to all of the local media using our own website and sending it to the organizations which we have members from for our committee. So we'll make sure we get it out to the colleges, universities. But as Superintendent said, we often go to recruitment fairs in other locations, but we'd like to have our own just to remind the community that we're looking for people from the city to come and work with our students.
One of the realities of living here in the Northeast, unfortunately, is that real estate and housing is very expensive. So I know that the issue of recruiting people from
down south
was voiced, and if that's a viable option, then so be it. But we do need to recognize that people from the Northeast are traveling south because you can get so much more value for a home and housing. You $250,000 down south in certain places gets you a beautiful home. $250,000 up north, you're a lot more limited just because of, our land, our real estate is just so much more expensive. So unfortunately, that's one of the barriers that was discussed with me from a person who actually came up here to visit their dad and do some business with him. And she went down to North Carolina and is really happy with what she's able to get for her dollar, for housing down there, So, but sorry, Elise.
Oh, it's okay. I just wanted to say at that meeting, I think there were a lot of great ideas, and I think everybody was there, and we all wanted the same thing. I think we all want to see a more diverse staff at our school, and great points were made, and I think everybody was in agreement. It seems to me our biggest challenge is the funding of it. Mm-hmm. And we want to hire more teachers, we want to have a more diverse school system, and yet we don't have the funds to do it. And I think that is where our real challenge lies. I think it's great we're opening up the dialogue, and I think we're all getting on the same page, and that's going to be our biggest challenge.
And Mrs. Plant, when you say we don't have the funds to do it, one of the things that clearly we talk about is as we hire teachers, and I'm talking about teaching staff, and we're letting go teachers every year. You hire teachers, and in the past couple of years, we've laid off 45, 60. So that's really set us back. I do have high hopes. when we talk about a Grow Your Own program. The mayor and I talk about this extensively, looking for businesses to join us. We have a great plan that Dr. Moran will share with you for our young people in future teacher clubs, Educator Rising clubs, collaboration with Bridgewater State University, Massasoit Community College, scholarship with. We have a lot of good things that are happening. And hopefully in a few years, you'll see the budget change and you'll see our Grow Your Own program where our students from Brockton High School, we don't have to have anybody come from the South. People that are comfortable living here, want to make a life here, want to come back to Brockton. We're seeing changes, and I think you'll see changes if we stick to our action plan and our goals, and that is a primary goal of our human resource office. So.
One thing I'd like to add, when the commissioner was here, I asked him about our certification process, and I see Ms. Smith over there from DESE, and DESE has made it very difficult and expensive to become a teacher. As a student, as an adult student at Bridgewater, I had to come up with hundreds of dollars to take tests that I didn't have. It was, you know, I'm feeding a family, working and going to college. They make it very difficult to become a teacher, and the commissioner wouldn't even accept that as anything of merit. So I think on a larger scale, until the state addresses that issue, we're not going to be able to recruit urban adults who want to be career changers like myself and a few other people that I know, where it was a bigger issue. It wasn't a bigger issue back, you know, 20 years ago. My father was a career changer, went to Bridgewater, went through a teacher education program, didn't have to jump through all the hoops, didn't have to take the test, and it was a lot cheaper. Now, a kid from Dorchester or Brockton who has, you know, is eating ramen noodles and Easy Mac every night, they have to scrape together $200, $300, $400 to get to their junior level classes. And that's a discouraging factor for a lot of kids that I knew at Bridgewater and, you know, in 2008 and in 1998 when I originally left high school. Now, as an adult, when I went through it, it was nearly impossible. I had to switch careers, work at night. So until the state addresses that, I wonder if that is anything else being worked on. Just put that bug in your ear. Well, I got you in front of me.
One of the things the mayor and I have talked about, when you talk about cost for teacher tests, we've talked about if the businesses truly want to support us, and that is something we're talking about in our action plan, you know, do we come forward and put money in for loan forgiveness? So those students that come back to us have an incentive, you know, to come back, they work.
Correct. Their test.
Yeah. So, all right, Dr. Moran, thank you.
Thank you.
All set. I want to jump around a little bit because I do see Dr. David Almeida here from Bridgewater State University. And we have a program that we're looking to. Do I see Dr. David Almeida here? Oh, no, he's not here. I'm sorry. I thought I had somebody here from Bridgewater State. So let me share with you exactly what's happening.
If he were here, this is what
this
he's
is exactly
say.
What he sent to me. I'm sorry. I thought he was. It's been a long night. So I do have a memo here, and this is from Dr. David Almeida, a professor of special education at Bridgewater State University. And one of the things that we're looking to do when you talk about trying to understand other cultures, and we look at our collaboration, and Mayor, I know you've worked very hard on this with our, you know, families that come from Cape Verde. We have a large population, and we're looking to do a teacher exchange program. In that teacher exchange program, and I do want the school committee to know that we do have our legal counsel looking at this proposal because it is something that we haven't done before. So this would allow us, and we're actually looking to possibly do this April, to invite a teacher from Cape Verde to come to, and we're particularly using the Huntington School to start because of our large Cape Verdean population there. They would come and spend a week to 10 days in Brockton. They would stay at a teacher's home. They would come to school. They would talk about collaborative ventures, look at the culture of our schools, talk about collaborations, and then bring that back during April vacation and probably some additional time where the teacher from Brockton would get an opportunity to go to Cape Verde on a teacher exchange program. So it is a first of its kind. We are working with a number of people, including our bilingual department. I'd like to invite our director of bilingual education, Kelly Jones, down to maybe answer any questions. I know she's been working on this, along with Mary Beth O'Brien, principal at the Huntington School, and Laurie Silva from Community Schools, who's worked on a number of these grants.
Good evening. So the proposal is Brockton teacher would host a Cape Verdean teacher for 1 week, and then that teacher would fly back with the Cape Verdean teacher over her April vacation or his April vacation, and spend the week staying in the family's house in São Felipe Fogo.
It's been a project that we've been working on. We started working on it at the beginning of last year, so it's been almost a 2-year full cycle that we've been working on this, working on logistics and seeing how things would work. Last year we had been working on it, and there were some issues with Cape Verdean teachers being able to come here, so we didn't even entertain our teachers going there at that point. So we've been spending the majority of this year working on planning and trying to see if we can work through all the issues that had caused some concerns last year to bring it to fruition this year, which is why at this point we felt it was appropriate to bring it to your attention, as well as legal and human resources. We've been working with human resources since the onset of the project, but we most definitely view it as a very essential component to bridging the communities, the cultures that are so prevalent in both both countries, and expanding upon the availabilities of growth for both.
And Professor Almeida will work with the teacher before going over to Cape Verde to orient her or him about schooling culture, and that teacher will come back and do a presentation in the school to share his or her knowledge and experiences with the larger school community.
And we've been able to look at ways to minimize the cost so that it's very minimal exposure as far as what Bridgewater State University, as well as the Brockton Public Schools, would have to put forward, as well as the individual teachers involved. So through looking at grant resources, Brockton Education Foundation on our side, and then Bridgewater as well looking at their resources, we've been able to keep it as a very minimal amount of funding that would be required to have this occur.
So this is an initial discussion. We will put this in your packet. We'll start to cost this out. As I said, it is in the hands of our legal department to make recommendations to you. We just received the proposal this week, but I wanted you, because of the time frame, I know you've been working on it, we wanted to at least put it out there for you to hear some of our concerns, but certainly benefits for both our Cape Verdean friends and certainly our Brockton Public School teachers.
Questions?
We were talking to start with
just one on each side. Yep,
in the beginning.
So very small pilot.
So we would first welcome the teacher from Cape Verde here, and then our teacher would go back to Cape Verde. So it would be within a two-week period in April.
Correct.
Not to start. You know, it's something new. It's.
Just
something we'd like to begin.
But we want to ensure that we have structures in place so that in the future, if we want to expand it further, we have kind of infrastructure ready to go.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. I'd like to also invite right now Dr. Sal Tarasi to come up. We put in your packet this past weekend, and when you talk about the NEA today, you know, having been part of the teachers union for many years, I always enjoyed receiving, you know, this journal, this magazine. It highlighted, you know, people from throughout the country with innovative practices, best practices, and this was something that we knew was coming. When you talk about our trauma-sensitive schools and a project that started back in really 2008, when we started to look at the supports that we needed to put in place for our students. And when you hear now, everywhere you look, journals, workshops, it's all about social and emotional learning. and it's something we've been doing really well for a lot of years. So we are so proud of being highlighted in the NEA Today magazine, Trauma and the Effects on Children and Learning, and I've invited Dr. Tarasi because I want to make sure that we don't leave anybody out, because I know it took a lot of people and a lot of years to actually have this recognition.
And there is no PowerPoint. I just thought you might want to see that. The NEA Today, that's the flagship magazine of the National Education Association. That's a national publication that goes to over 3 million educators across the country. And Brockton happens to be the cover article for the winter edition. It's a quarterly publication. And it's featuring Brockton educators, the Arnone School, the George School, the Barrett Russell School, the Brookfield School, all mentioned, teachers in those schools that have participated in the helping traumatized children learn courses that we run in partnership with Lesley University. We've done a lot of training of our educators. The staff in those schools have, you know, really thought through how to personalize the school to meet the social and emotional needs of children in their population. They have mindfulness practice that they're doing with children. I think the superintendent visited the George School and even saw a first grade classroom practicing mindfulness-based exercises. Teachers are reporting anecdotally that it really seems to resonate with the children. They're learning how to control their behavior in more powerful ways. It's affecting, you know, what we call psychologically their self-regulation skills, their executive function skills, that's their decision making. And you know, we're seeing good news on that front. We have reflection rooms in other schools where students, you know, have the opportunity not only to experience a consequence, punishment for bad behavior, but to work out with a counselor or a staff person in a restorative way. What can we now do to make that right? And there was, you know, a story of a young child who had pulled a fire alarm, who thought that what he ought to do to make it right was to pay a visit to the kindergarten classes and explain to the younger children why that wasn't a good thing to do and why that wasn't why that was a danger to safety, and what he had learned from that experience. So you know, we're really trying to work on fostering emotional well-being, balance, good decision making, and you know, Brockton is being recognized on several fronts. One of our psychologists has been invited to present at a conference in San Antonio. The superintendent has been invited to present on social emotional learning in Los Angeles. Okay. I was asked to participate earlier this year in a conference in Washington at the White House, and so Brockton is really being recognized for very, very good work, and we just hope to be able to continue it in light of obviously the budget that we're going to be facing and the cutbacks. I mean, we need more adjustment counselors, not fewer. We need more nurses, not fewer. And so it's, on the one hand, it's a great shot in the arm and a wonderful compliment. And on the other hand, it's a little bit discouraging when we look at what the current realities are fiscally.
But I invite any of you, if you'd like to come to a visit to a number of these schools. It certainly doesn't look like, you know, school as we knew it or I knew it many years ago, you know, to look at some of these reflection rooms, areas in classrooms where kids can go and, as Dr. Tarasi said, you know, think about their decision making or really kind of regulate so they can put themselves back into the classroom. I went and watched children at the Arnone School. I've been to the George School, to the Baker School, to the little children at the Barrett Russell School. And Dr. Tarasi and I were laughing about a little first grade class that I went to that were very serious about what they were learning and looking at their brain and how their brain functions. And I really had to re-educate myself in some of the terms that the children were sharing with me to understand their thought process and why they were making decisions that they were making. I asked them if it's something that they share at home, and it is. It's something that goes home. They share with their parents, their brothers and sisters, and make sure that the family remains, you know, regulated also. It was very interesting.
We heard, you know, stories come back, anecdotal stories. Part of the curriculum is that the children are learning about their brains and the brain structure and how it is that their brains control their behavior, control their decision-making, and control their emotions. And they're developing a deeper understanding of their behavior and their emotions and how to control it. And part of that is learning about the structures in the brain. And you know, as little, typically little boys might do in line, one kid was getting a little bit rambunctious, and the girl behind him, I think third grade, tapped him on the shoulder and said, "You've got to stop that. Your amygdala is out of control."
It's great. It's great. Okay, so thank you very much. Congratulations to our teachers out there in all of our schools, to our staff that continue to employ these practices. These are best practices, and you continue to hear me say it, to support our children so that they are able to do what they need to do, which is certainly the instruction in our classrooms every day. It truly is wraparound. It's social and emotional learning at its best. You know, thank you very much, Dr. Tracy. And I'd like to invite up Dr. Cliff Murray for, and this will be a PowerPoint presentation. We're going to hear tonight about the West Middle School Wolverines. I do see a member of your staff, Mr. Campbell, up back here to support you. Dr. Murray.
The biggest challenge will be getting the PowerPoint ready here.
Okay,
so
well, we're going to move away.
It's 40 slides, so about a minute a slide, so we'll be out of here by noon.
No. You're awake?
Oh, there you go. Yeah, somebody laughs.
Oh, fuck.
Okay, so first of all, I just want to say that I have the good fortune of working with some incredible groups of people, really three, and it's the first group are the parents and students in our building. We've got a great family-oriented community there, and our students and their parents are fantastic. I also have the pleasure of working with some incredible educators who are very dedicated. I think as we go through these slides, you'll get to see some of the things that they've done with their students that are very unique and very special. And then, of course, the third group is our support staff. The building that we have and the grounds are incredibly clean. Our custodians, stop! And that was it, ladies and gentlemen. Help! Is that my amygdala, Mr. Dr. Tarassi, or what? So anyway, we'll go on with the show as soon as I fix the broken computer. If it starts to smoke, then I'm going to run. It's the scary Wolverine. If you lose this PowerPoint, you get too good at dinner on me.
It's just slow. You can keep talking.
The computer is sad because of the budget. Well, West has been open 65 years, opened in 1952, and currently we're using 32 spaces in the building as classrooms. Of course, we have a full gym and an auditorium. We have a lot of other spaces that we use. We have a reflection room, as Dr. Tarassi alluded to, a lot of other small spaces where we try to do individual work with our students. The building is filled with a very diverse student population, and as a result, we have a lot of kind of special things going on. So we'll get started with the PowerPoint because the hour is late. Thank you. So these are on about a 10-second delay. So again, about 630 students, a large staff. We have a number of special education programs along with advanced students and the largest gen ed population in the middle schools. This is our class of 2017. There are actually 209 students there. The math teacher has a grid, and they love standing out there in the fall. It's kind of the way we start the year off with our eighth grade. Kindness Club. This is one of the areas I'm speaking about. Many of you heard about a guest that we had last year, but this is a mathematics teacher whose students came to her and spoke about concerns with the way they treated each other in school. They started things like a beautification program in our building. They actually went to our neighbors and gave them flowers last spring. Done all kinds of good deeds. The teacher actually reached out to the Patriots, and you may recognize Malcolm Butler, actually came to the school, was fantastic. What a gentleman, what an inspiration to our students, and also did his first ESPN interview there. Spent so much time with these students in this club, it was really incredible. His handlers actually had to get him to leave. So again, something a teacher just did on her own. And I'm bigger than him, so I thought that was pretty cool. Yeah. Student life, we have all kinds of activities here at West. Many of our students, well, all of our seventh graders last year had an opportunity to go to Massasoit. We have students that go to Bridgewater State for City Lab. We have the Stonehill Mentoring program as well, where they do mentoring through the arts. These are some students at Massasoit. They spent the day there and engaged in a bunch of different activities. They had a great time. They got some t-shirts. It was very meaningful. They actually had a lot to say about their trip to the college, and I think it had a big impact on them thinking about being able to go to school. That was one of the things. They heard a lot of stories. Some of our classrooms, on the left is the science classroom. Some of our special ed kids doing experiments, totem. These are our students at Bridgewater State. That is the president of Bridgewater State College. He surprised them with donuts and hot cocoa when they went up there for a lab. So partners with Bridgewater State, as many of our other buildings. We are very fortunate to have an outdoor picnic area. As you can see, some of the students were relaxing this fall in the nice weather with the umbrellas. It's a great place for them to kind of relax during the day. And then we have athletic teams. I mean, the hybrid sports program that you approved this year has been fantastic. I actually like this model better. We've had upwards of 50 young ladies and almost 100 young men playing basketball. Again, some classroom activities in a math room and a science room.
Can you just elaborate on the hybrid model?
I will. Let me just run through this really quick. Again, a couple of more activities. Because if I try to shut this off, it'll probably shut off. Our music department actually did a survey of different types of, we're trying cross-curricular activities, including graphing and mathematics with music. These are students that were at Stonehill. And one of our teachers has got a couple of different projects going on with Stonehill. And one of them was designing a walking trail. It's Mr. Conley. Drama, chorus, band, these are all activities. We have 150 students involved in chorus, probably another 100 involved in the band and the drama production. As you can see, they all seem to enjoy themselves. And these are just some of our students in some of the spaces. This is what you're thinking about and worrying about in these meetings. This is the reason why we're all here. That's our girls' chorus. The boys' chorus on the right, there's a combined honors chorus. So again, we have about 150 to about 170 students involved in that. The chorus production. This is something I'm very proud of. This year we collected over 3,000 cans for St. Edith Stein. The students did this, they thought of it. They did it on their own. We actually had to make two trips with two pickups. We had a little competition between homerooms, but 3,000 cans. We had students whose parents came and asked, you know, they didn't have anything to give. Somehow they found food and brought it in. So very, very proud of them. Student council. They do a lot within the building, within the community. We had a neighbor who had a house fire. We didn't realize who it was, but they still collected $300. And then we found out it was somebody that was in the schools. So, very caring group. Again, our band, we have a 7th and 8th grade band, a 6th grade band, and they're combined. They have jazz band. Lots of opportunities for students to get involved. We did have kind of a unique visit. The U.S. Attorney Carmen Ortiz visited. The mayor was president maybe, who knows. The district attorney, Mr. Cruz, was there, the superintendent. We had a former student of the alternative school, LaShawn Amato, spoke, very powerful. And then one of the really neat things was afterwards, we had, through Mr. Cruz's office, a huge program set up in our gymnasium where there were all kinds of tables with things to line kids up with activities in the summer, various resources that they could access if they felt they needed them. And the students were really moved by LaShawn's comments, and then again by all the things they were able to take advantage of in the gymnasium. It was really something very special. And again, the students seemed to really enjoy that. So that's a quick presentation, very brief, like 7 minutes. But the hybrid sports program you asked about, to me, it's a success. My goal, or at least my vision for that, was that we would have more students involved and participating. In the past, middle school sports, again, because of safety concerns and the budget and so forth and so on, limited the numbers. It was a sport where, for instance, in basketball, you'd only take maybe 15 or 18 students. And this is a way that they were able to play for 5 weeks, kind of in a competitive environment with some coaching, but at the same time, they weren't cut. We mixed the teams up. I think all the schools pretty much kept true to that format. And this week, I think starting Thursday, we start some inter-school games, and they've selected groups of 20 to play. So it worked well in the fall. We're very excited about volleyball next, because we have co-ed volleyball, and there's a lot of interest in that. It always has been. And then, of course, we're trying to map out a strategy for our spring sports, where we may do something a little different, again, for safety's sake, with baseball and softball, still allowing students to participate, and then provide some other sports as well, flag football, wiffle ball, kickball, those kinds of things. But again, the idea is to have students out there moving, socializing, having some fun, and getting some exercise. And I would say that the decision to fund that, although a difficult one with the budget, was a resounding success. Instead of having a tryout for perhaps 3 or 4 days where you have 50 or 60 kids and then you pick 18 or 20 kids to play the rest of the time, we've had 5 weeks of consistent numbers where you've had 45 to 50 students. So much so that we actually had to divide them up into groups. Okay. Some of the buildings have switched things around so that we had kids come in the morning so their teams could play. The other thing is, the girls typically never seemed to have the numbers when it was done the other way. And I was really pleased. We had about 45 young ladies involved in basketball, different skill levels, so we divided them up into different groups, but they seemed to enjoy it and stay interested in. So that was, I think that's what we should be doing.
So do you find that the culture and the climate of the school benefits from having this type of an after-school program?
Any time that we can get students to do something in the building with staff that is not necessarily academic related, where they can kind of get to know the teachers on a different level, they're getting some exercise, they're having some fun, in some cases they're learning some skills, clearly has improved the behaviors and the atmosphere of the schools, at least in my opinion. I know in my building personally, I think it's made a big difference.
Great.
I really do.
Good.
So.
Couple things. One, I just had a couple of recent opportunities to come to West, and you had just had a bit of a history fair
National History Day is another.
Yeah, day. History Day. And the students that, you know, put presentations together for that, they did an absolutely spectacular job. You had some that chose to use the tablets that we have for digital presentations, and some that went with a more traditional poster board type presentation, but they all did a great job, you know, and I had a chance to talk to a few of the students, and they had done their research, and I was quite impressed with what they had done. And then also had the opportunity to come and you know, walk around the school with you and learn a little bit more about West and everything going on there. So I wanted to thank you for the time you spent with me, because I know you're busy and you probably spent a little more time with me than you'd planned on, but it was I really truly appreciate it.
Again, I think, especially with all of the difficult decisions that you're facing, I would encourage you to go to any school. You're always welcome. And that's what you're there. This is what you're worrying about, is those pictures that you've seen this evening and what you've seen. So I would invite you and encourage you to go, because I think I'm incredibly proud of all the schools at the middle level, but all the schools in Brockton. It's a great place to work and to teach, and I think you can feel that when you walk into the building. So that's what you're struggling with all these difficult questions for, is the kids, and it's neat to go and see them in action.
With the 17, where was somebody standing? Is that a drone?
I can't even work a laptop. No.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
The thing would crash right into the building. No, I go up on the roof, but then I have somebody else go over near the edge. Huh?
Did you say you went up on the roof?
I go up on the roof a bunch of different times. Oh, no. Mr. Campbell and I are smart enough not to go near the edge, but we have other staff that like to lean right over and take a picture.
Oh, boy.
Did you use a selfie stick?
No, I used the inclusion teacher. I said, go ahead. They wanted to do it. So now, we've done this about 3 or 4 years. We make copies for every student. They actually put them on their binder, and it's pretty neat, because they see it all year long. You see it all year long. And then the other thing that Mr. DiAgostino saw is one of the things that we're trying to do is we just gave all of our eighth graders IDs, just like the ones that they used to have at Brockton High. And we're talking about doing your job. I showed the superintendent getting ready for high school. And we've asked the high school for just a couple of hints about things that they can start thinking about and preparing for, so that when they walk in that door as ninth graders, as freshmen, they're good to go. And, you know, I was mixed emotions about what the response would be with the kids. We brought them into the auditorium. We had this big, you know, chat. And it's incredible how many of them have taken this to heart and who are wearing their IDs, and I think are kind of proud of it and are very excited. It's kind of created a little bit of a buzz. We're going to get some people down from the high school in March when they start to talk about schedules to start thinking about high school. So we have a great, great staff, great kids, and it's a lot of fun.
And tomorrow night is the orientation for eighth graders.
Correct.
At Brockton High.
Correct.
School. So all those parents that want to, you know, hear the presentation and come and see the high school, we invite you to come up here tomorrow evening at Brockton High School. I'm not sure if it's 6 or 6:30, but again, it's 6 at Brockton High.
6 o'clock.
Do the other middle schools have the eighth graders wearing IDs as well?
No. Actually, we meet as a group once a month. I told them what I was going to do. We were very fortunate. The high school had the old ID makers, so it actually didn't cost us the darn thing. And I said, why don't you let me try it? We'll just see how it's received. Probably a dozen years ago, we tried IDs at the middle schools, junior highs actually then, and it did not go over well. So we looked at this a little differently. It was more of kind of a fun way to say, you go to the high school now, you have to have an ID to get in. And so why don't we start practicing, you know, bringing your ID to school. You know, the second day we did it, it was cold and rainy, and I was outside saying, you know, if you have your ID, just walk right in. So I think my colleagues are fully intending to try to do that going forward. And we'd kind of like to do some other things as a group so that perhaps all of them are kind of on the same page when they get to the high school.
I'd love to see if this does make a difference, if it helps prepare them at the high school, if they're less forgetful with their IDs once they get up to the high school, and to see how this, if this is really, you know, going to help them at that level, and if so, if we should implement it in the other schools.
We've used some bribes, Skittles and Starburst, you know, in the hallway, but we've made it, try to make it fun, and I think they've taken it to heart. So some of the other things we're talking about, you know, homework, study habits, those kinds of things, behavior.
Thank you.
Sorry, I know we've gone on for a long time, but you know, when you were talking, the other thing that jumped out at me that I just wanted to say and give all of the, I mean, the teachers as well as the principals and all of our schools credit for is, you know, when, whether it was South or West, or I spent some time at Huntington today as well, you know, the relationships that the teachers and the principals have with so many of the students in the school, it's just impressive that, you know, there's a school of 600 kids and, you know, you, and like I said, many of the other principals, I've observed that they know you, you know them, you know, you have a rapport with them, and it's great to see that.
To be honest with you, since I started in Brockton 18 years ago, there is a chemistry, kind of a rapport that the teachers have with their students and that they have with each other. And really the best people we can go for help or for resources is our colleagues. And so I think we have an excellent teaching staff in all the buildings, and we're very fortunate to have administrators that really care. And I think that shows, and the students and their parents. We get a lot of help from our parents. There's a lot of cooperation. We're not perfect, you know, we have issues, but like any big family, that happens. So I think it's unique, I really do. And I'm proud to be part of that, really.
And I think you probably saw with the Patriots on Sunday, when I think back to all of those students at West last year with Malcolm Butler, and that was his first appearance publicly, you know, being able to speak like that, and he was excellent. He truly related to those kids, and I'm going to bet you as I watched him Sunday night, every single one of them was rooting for him, along with Danny Amendola, who came to our Davis right. school not too long ago, and again, you know, fabulous. So I thought of those kids on Sunday night, how exciting it must have been for them to really cheer on, again, not just a great football player, great with our kids, great message. And that was your teacher that brought him.
Well, that was our math teacher who sent a letter to the Patriots, and I kind of scoffed and said, yeah, go ahead, knock yourself out. And they called on a Monday and said, we can have a frontline player there Wednesday if you could change your schedule. And I told them, no, I was busy, I had math lab, we couldn't do it. So I said, sure, whatever you want to come by, come by. And so they had done this through the math teacher, so they contacted her and told her who the player was, and she came up to me and she goes, who's that? She was like, who's that? And I went, the guy that won the Super Bowl. And she goes, who's that? So it was funny, but the kids were very surprised. They had no idea. And he was really a very, very charming, very engaging. And Patriots class group, just a great organization.
Well, I think we should invite him back. So let's make this a formal invitation for Danny Amendola and Malcolm Butler, or anyone else that would like to come speak to our kids. So, great year.
Great.
Thank you very much.
Yep, thank you.
And I know I've got a number of other things. I'm going to put them off until next time. I will talk about some, I went to the Brockton High School Science Fair. I saw certainly a number of community people there. It is amazing what these kids do, how they explain their project, how they talk about their research and move on to fairs at a state level and a national level. Thank you to our teachers and our staff that continues to support all of our students. I also, and this doesn't always happen, the one I try to get out to see the athletic events, I made it to a basketball game. They were playing Bridgewater Raynham, who again has an excellent team. I will be able to say that we did win this game. It was a very competitive game. I believe on their home field, their home court, they won the first game. So it was just a great game to see. I'm trying to get out there to see hockey, girls basketball, and again, all the wonderful things happening. And last but not least, I went to the mentor rally sponsored by our YMCA and spoke last Thursday evening. And again, as always, we're looking for mentors, you know, for our students. If you do want to be a mentor, get in touch with Amanda Trask through the YMCA. And again, they do a great job. And that's it for tonight.
All right,
do have a few items under new business.
What's a school committee?
Oh, I'm sorry, subcommittee, items to refer to subcommittee.
Do that?
Yep,
okay.
I'm sorry, items to refer to subcommittee.
Items to refer to subcommittee.
Okay, we do have a facilities meeting that we're looking for February 28th. We also are looking for some time, and this will depend on the budget, we'll set up all our budget meetings to be on those Tuesday nights that are not school committee meetings. That will start immediately for our finance meetings, and that will include the discussion we had this evening. We'll make sure that that gets on there. We all, we can do them both on the 28th, correct. 28th is, I'm trying to think, today is the 7th, so that becomes 3 weeks. Of course, we have February vacation in the middle of that.
It's the extra Tuesday. I think finance is going to take precedence on that, so we'll have to get that rescheduled.
Okay, we could even start a little bit early, and I'll have to see on the accounts review if you're able to make it 15 minutes earlier. We possibly can get in three meetings on the 28th.
Okay.
Three subcommittees.
I'll just check in with you on that, and we'll see how we can make that work.
And the other thing I just want to bring to your attention, I'll be following up with you on under a superintendent contract, it really is the goal setting piece. So we'll look at that sometime for April and May once we get into our budget season. We'll also have to talk to you about following up with Dorothy Presser if there are some areas that we want to cover with modules on governance, on protocols, on working with setting the goals. So I'll have Wanda survey you and see what you'd like to do, but you know, short of doing anything, we do have to move forward and have a meeting where the goals are approved for this upcoming year. I think that's it. Okay, all set, Mayor.
All set. All right, new business. So superintendent of the school committee, what is that right there? Looking to designate someone?
Yeah, this came up in our retreat, Save Our Sports. We were looking to, as we have for community schools and other organizations when we do our organizational meeting, to add Save Our Sports so that we have a voice as a school committee. I believe Mr. Gormley had volunteered to put his name in for serving on that.
All right, does that require a vote, or are we just letting everybody know? Everybody okay with Brett on Save Our Sports? You're in, Brett.
So we'll be adding that to our list of what we do each year when we have our organizational meeting at the start of the year. We'll add that.
Thank you.
Okay. Tom, do we want it? What's that?
We should vote him on.
You need a vote?
Send him a vote.
Okay.
I'll make the motion to
appoint Mr. Brett Gormley as the school committee representative to the Save Our Sports designation school committee as the school committee representative.
Motion's made, properly seconded. Did anyone else want to run against Brett for this position?
Or? Well, you're
going to erase
them. Absolutely.
Put my cap. All right, motion's made and properly seconded. All in favor? All right, Brett, you're officially in now.
Thank you. I just to add quickly, one of the reasons I wanted to make that an official subcommittees because we do a lot of collaboration with that group. They've sponsored high school intramurals when we have budget shortfalls, and we're building a strength and conditioning room, or redoing our strength and conditioning room in the high school. Thanks to them, mostly. They funded 2/3 of it. We only had to come up with 1/3, and that's something that has been talked about for many, many years, and thanks to Save Our Sports, we were able to do that. So it's good to have somebody there to know what's going on with those things and to just keep a pulse on what's going on with the huge athletic program that we have.
I think it's a real good idea, maybe something, Brett, we could look at this year is what we could do to help them recruit some newer people to come in, because we've got some great folks there, but it's been a lot of the same folks there for a long time. And you know, with 4,500 students in the school, I can't believe we don't have 8 or 10 parents whose kids were involved in sports would be willing to jump in and help out.
Yeah. I mean, I'm one of those parents now, so I can definitely recruit some folks that I already am doing volunteer work with. So that's a great thing.
I think it's a great idea to have a liaison directly with the school committee, particularly they do so much good work over the years.
They're wonderful to us.
Particularly the SAT prep class they sponsor.
Yes, and that's something I told somebody about recently. They had no idea, and that's something that Frank Brockton High's athletes have been having issues with lately, getting into colleges, as they've said, your SATs aren't there. So it's there for everybody, not just the athletes. So that's something that people at home should know about for their students, is we do offer SAT prep courses for free.
Yep, terrific. Okay, Brett, you're officially in.
Thank you.
So Tom, do we need to do this FinCom report now, or you didn't really take any action? We'll wait until you...
We did one item before you...
Oh, you did, I'm sorry. Then go ahead. Recognize Tom for a report on the FinCom meeting.
I'll be quick. The Finance Subcommittee meeting met at 6:30 this evening. All members were present. We discussed adding some athletic coaching positions, which were not included in the budget originally. We also discussed, and those positions, three positions were voted in. The substitute issue with respect to compensation was discussed, and that issue was tabled, and it looks like we'll be discussing that further on the 28th of February. That basically is the gist of the Finance Subcommittee meeting, so I would make a motion to approve the contents thereof.
Okay. Motion to approve the report. Motion to approve the report.
Seconded. All in favor? Approved.
Then, with respect to the contents of that meeting with regard to votes, there were three positions that were added: the freshman baseball coach and a boys and a girls track coach, for a total of three positions, which totaled $11,722. Those positions were approved by all members of the committee. So I would ask for a motion to ratify that vote.
Okay, so we want to formally ratify the addition, the appropriation for the three additional coaches that was taken by the FinCom earlier this evening. So we'll take a motion on that.
I'll make that motion.
Okay, motion made, seconded. All in favor? Okay, officially approved. That take care of FinCom?
That's it.
All right. So then we do have another important piece of business here, and that's the ratification of the MOA between the school committee and food services. Brockton Food Service Associates, Local 888. I'm not sure who was on that negotiating unit. So does someone want to present this to the full committee? All right, Judy, go ahead.
I'd like to thank Brett and Tim, who also worked with me on this. And we have Matt Beals here from HR, and also Jean Zeeler, our legal counsel. The Brockton Public Schools food service workers do a lot of work. I found that out by attending this contract. They not only prepare the food, cook it, set up, serve, clean up two meals a day for our school community, which in itself is a lot of work, and they work hard. There is also breakfast in the classroom and catering that they do. This is a very nice group to work with. They brought us chocolate chip cookies every meeting, so we were really excited. They work hard for our kids and our teachers. I learned a lot about what they do for the Brockton Public School every day.
Okay. So based upon that then, is there a motion to approve the contract that all members have been presented a copy with the agreement in advance? It's actually an MOA. Okay. Motion's been made and properly seconded. All in favor? Approved. They do a great job for us.
They work very hard.
I still love school lunch. American chop suey is still one of my favorite meals. Anything else under new business?
I just have two quick things before we leave, if nobody else does. So first of all, I want to mention to everybody that Donna Migdale, our executive assistant, retired yesterday. So yesterday was her last day after over 20 years in the district. I want to thank Donna publicly for everything that she has done, going back to being a parent and being on the PACs, to parent liaisons at North, to administrative assistant jobs, and finally confidential, and finally in the office of the superintendent. Certainly during my 4 years, it has positioned me to be able to deal with the day-to-day things. She truly was a wonderful team member and supporter for all of us. I wish her just so much luck in her retirement. I'm sure she'll up her golf game greatly. So I, again, want to thank Donna Migdale for everything that she has done for the Brockton Public Schools. And I want to finish by calling to your attention Cracker Jacks, which I'm sure the public is looking at and wondering why there are Cracker Jacks at your seat. So we had a retreat a couple of weeks ago. It was well over 6 hours. And before the retreat started, I was kidding about doing something for the school committee that would make them be pleased that they were sitting for 6 hours on a Saturday. And a gentleman said to me, well, why not Cracker Jacks? There's a prize in every box. And of course, I forgot to get it for you. So Mr. Minicello went out and got all of these Cracker Jacks for us to remind us what it was like to be a kid. And I could not wait to get to the bottom. I dumped it all out to get to the prize and ate the Cracker Jacks afterwards. So thank you, Mr. Minicello. And Mickey Campbell, that's right. That's right, one of the Dew Boys.
That's it.
That's okay. It.
Anyone else on a new business? Someone got a motion to adjourn? Please.
Motion to adjourn. Yeah.
Motion made properly, second. All in favor? Meeting adjourned. Thank you very much.